Okay. So let me just check the technology. That seems to be working. Hello, welcome. My name is Sean Prendeville, and this is another third of our six lectures on Fourier methods in combinatorial number theory. So this is being recorded. So do be aware of that if you decide to interact. I hope that doesn't inhibit interaction too much. Please do unmute yourself and ask a question if you have one, or ask a question in the chat. Hopefully every now and again I'll be able to monitor that chat and come back to your question, or use the raise your hand feature. There'll be an opportunity for questions at the end when I'm going to stop recording. So I hope you feel even less inhibited to ask a question at that point. If there are any technical issues, for instance, if you can't see what I'm writing, or you can't hear me, or you can't see the video, do let me know. Possibly the easiest way is by the chat. If there are any accessibility issues with the notes or with the video or with the slides, let me know via email, and hopefully we can try and resolve those together. So as I always say, the notes are available on the webpage for this course, and I send them around every week. Those notes are where I put the details of the arguments I'm going to give. I'm hoping to use these lectures as more of a kind of a big picture. So I'll be a bit fast and loose with the details, and I hope you'll permit me that. Okay, so I think that's all I want to say in terms of an introduction. Do let me know if you can't see the slides. So what are we going to talk about today? So I want to motivate this notion of arithmetic regularity with posing this problem of how do we globally count solutions to an equation given a set of integers for which we only have combinatorial hypotheses. For instance, we only know its density. So the solution I'm going to propose for that problem is the arithmetic regularity lemma. And I'll state it, but I won't prove it today. We'll prove it in lecture six. And I want to show you how useful the regularity lemma is by giving an application. Okay, so here's the problem. We're given a set of integers in this interval, 1 up to n, and all we know about it is its density. It's got density delta. And we've, throughout this course, we've been sort of considering this paradigm of trying to count solutions to a linear equation where the variables are constrained to our set A. How do we count that? How do we analyze that count? How do we obtain upper bounds, lower bounds, asymptotic formulae? Well, in lecture one, we showed that if our set A was what we called Fourier uniform, its Fourier transform resembled a rescaled version of the Fourier transform of the whole interval, then we could count this sum. In fact, we could obtain an asymptotic formula for the number of solutions to an equation in our Fourier uniform set. So that's the best possible result. Now, random sets are Fourier uniform, random sets of density delta. So almost every set is Fourier uniform. But unfortunately, lots of sets of interest are not Fourier uniform. And that's because interesting sets are constructed in a deterministic way, probably using algebra. So they have some algebraic structure. So they're probably not going to be random. So how do we globally count solutions to our equation for sets of interest? Sets which aren't necessarily random. So in lecture two, we gave a sort of partial solution to that, which showed that if we started off with a dense set, provided we were happy to count solutions where variables were constrained to our set intersected with some small progression p, then we could still obtain an asymptotic formula, a local asymptotic formula on this subprogression p. So in one way, that's fantastic. We get an asymptotic formula. But in another sense, it's bad because we've counted a very small proportion of solutions to the equation in the interval. And today we're interested in counting solutions globally on the whole interval. So how do we globally count solutions? So here's what we're going to propose as a solution for that. It's this arithmetic regularity lemma. And I'll state it in a heuristic way first. Perhaps the first pass is to say, well, arithmetic regularity tells you every set is essentially a Bohr translate. That's not quite right. It tells you that the only sets you need to worry about are Bohr translates. In that if you want to analyze this sum, the only problem you have to solve is the problem for a Bohr translate. Because every set is a Bohr translate plus a random set, essentially. And why don't we have to worry about the random part? Well, it's because random sets obey the naive heuristic. So we know how to analyze this sum for the random part. And analyzing the sum for the Bohr translate is a bit more involved. It involves some number theory. So we've reduced this sort of combinatorial problem to a number theoretic problem. It's not a particularly involved number theoretic problem. Again, this isn't quite right. This heuristic is wrong, because regularity says you actually get a decomposition of your set in terms of a Bohr translate and a random set, plus a small exceptional set, okay? So there is something called the weak regularity lemma, where you don't have to worry about this small exceptional set. But in the weak regularity lemma, the quality of randomness in your random set is sort of comparable to the complexity of your Bohr set. Why that's a problem is, this lower bound that you obtain for a Bohr translate, lower bound for this number of solutions to your equation, will depend on the complexity of your Bohr set. And if the error term coming from the random set is of a similar quality to the main term coming from the Bohr translate, the error term might outweigh the main term. But full arithmetic regularity says you can obtain a random set whose randomness is arbitrarily small in terms of the complexity of your Bohr set. So it's much more random than the complexity of your Bohr set. And the price you have to pay for that is tolerating a small exceptional set. So this is a set which is sort of moderately random. Or, I mean, in the heuristic way I'm talking about this, that's the same as saying moderately Bohr. It's sort of on the intermediate of this spectrum. It's neither very random nor very Bohr structured. But why we can tolerate it in this sum is because it's small. Okay, so that's a very heuristic way of stating it. Let me state the regularity lemma in a little more precision. So I'm going to start very imprecise and try and refine my statement of the theorem into something more and more precise. The eventual statement of the dilemma will take up the whole slide. And I worried if I stated it straight off by taking up the whole slide, that might put most of you off, and you definitely won't be able to pass it in one go. So we're going to start by sort of looking at the headlines and the takeaways, and then making those takeaways more and more accurate until we got something which actually is true. So the regularity lemma says you can decompose an indicator function of a set in terms of a structured part, a Bohr translate, a small part, small exceptional set, and a random part, a part which is highly Fourier uniform. That's our headline. So as I say, the structured part is a Bohr translate. The small part is sort of a weighted indicator function of a small exceptional set. So in order to get a Bohr translate from your original set, you might have to throw some points in. And you might also have to take some other points away. So that's why you get a plus or minus here. It's a plus or minus a small exceptional set. And we get a highly Fourier uniform set. Again, plus or minus. So this isn't the truth. This isn't what actually you get given in the regularity lemma, but it's a way to think about it. So that reduces counting solutions to an equation in your dense set to counting solutions in a Bohr translate, in the structured part. Because we know how to count solutions coming from a small exceptional set. Essentially, there's a small number of solutions coming from a small set. And we know how to count solutions coming from a uniform set because we have the naive heuristic. So analyzing the count for both of these functions is easy, and we've reduced the problem to analyzing the problem for a Bohr translate. So in the literature, sometimes you see it stated that the regularity lemma reduces the task of solving a problem to checking the result for a nil sequence or a character or a Bohr translate or a Bohr set. So that's what I'm trying to communicate here. But let's make these quite woolly, hand-wavy statements a bit more precise. So what does the indicator function of a Bohr translate look like? Well, it looks like the indicator function of a box on the torus. In some high-dimensional torus. And you take your integer and you map it to the torus by multiplying it by a frequency vector, a vector of frequencies. So the image to have in your mind is you've got the unit circle, and we have some interval along the unit circle, and we're pulling that interval back to the integers. This isn't what is given by the regularity lemma. The regularity lemma actually gives you not a discrete cutoff. So what does the indicator function of a box or of an interval is some discrete cutoff. And this isn't what's given by the regularity lemma. And in fact, it's more useful to have a smoother cutoff, have some sort of smoother bump function. So we've got a continuous cutoff, evaluated at the same thing, frequency vector times our integer. So it's some continuous function. But continuous functions are pretty wild. This is sort of content-free, stated at this level of generality. So actually, we have to quantify how continuous this function is. And the way we'll do that is we'll quantify its Lipschitz constant. So we say it's M Lipschitz. What does M Lipschitz mean? It means if you perturb this function, this continuous function, by beta, then you get the function evaluated at the original point, alpha, plus an error term, which is determined by some metric on our torus. Here's my metric. Times my Lipschitz constant. Actually, the implicit constant here is one, but I've just written it this way because it's a more convenient way that I like to think about it. So there's no implicit constants here. But essentially, if you perturb your function at some beta, you get the function at the original point alpha with some error term, depending on the distance to your original point. So it's a quantitative notion of continuity. Now you might ask, where does this M come from? So M is measuring the complexity of our structured part. So if you take a higher dimensional torus, you get a more complicated Bohr set, and it's got more freedom and less rigidity. If you take a function with a higher Lipschitz constant, it's also got more freedom, less rigidity. So this M is measuring the complexity of our Bohr translate. And we'll get into the quantitative dependence of N on other parameters later.
Excuse me for interrupting. Can I ask a question?
Please do, yeah.
You mentioned complexity of a Bohr set for a few times and also in your lecture notes, but you have never defined it. Can you explain a bit what you mean by complexity? And also the other thing is that you defined here a Lipschitz function with maximum of in beta i's, and in your lecture notes you defined it as a minimum of beta i's. So is it important or is it just a notational?
So that's an error. So this is maximum or minimum according to whichever one is correct, and I'm prone to errors, so whichever one's right, whichever one gives you an actual metric. Your first question is good, what's complexity? So here I'm defining complexity to be M. It's the Lipschitz constant of your function and it's the dimension of your torus. For a discrete Bohr set where you've got a discrete cutoff, not a smoothed out Bohr set, then I would say the complexity is the dimension, the maximum of the dimension of the rate and one over the radius. But I haven't defined it because I don't need to define it. But so it's a sort of heuristic definition with no precise application in what I'm going to talk about. But yeah, you can think of it as one over the radius, or the maximum of one over the radius with the dimension.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, no problem. Thanks for the question. Okay. So let's start looking at the small part. So it's not an indicator function, the small part. It's a bounded function. It takes values between -1 and 1, and its L1 norm is small. What's the L1 norm? According to my notation, the way I've normalized, it's just the sum of the function, the absolute value of the function. Okay, so the small part is a function with small mass. And why is the mass small? Well, it's an epsilon fraction of the largest it could be. So with my normalization, this number here is n. That's the maximum possible mass a one-bounded function could have. So it's a small function, small in mass. And the uniform part, so it's a function whose Fourier transform is very small, very small. Again, it's one-bounded. It's not an indicator function. So this isn't what I've usually said for Fourier uniform. Normally, Fourier uniform means a...
Hi. The second function was supposed to be somehow random-like, right?
So just to say, the first function is structured, the second function is an exceptional set, small, and the third function is the random one. So I've probably changed the order in which I've written
things. But then this FSML, that can be plus one on odds and minus one on evens?
The small function, yeah, it could be like that, yeah. As long as it's equal to one on a small fraction of evens and odd on a small fraction of odds. So it's not an indicator function, it's just...
No, but you are saying that, but... Oh, sorry. Okay, now I get it. Sorry, that was a stupid question, sorry.
No, it's okay. It's good to have questions. I'm glad people are asking questions. Okay, so we've got structured part, small part, and you asked about random part. That's the uniform part. And the randomness is measured by how small the Fourier transform is. So if you think about this on the unit circle, it's very equidistributed. And it's not uniform in that its Fourier transform is comparable to the Fourier transform of an interval. It's just got small Fourier coefficients everywhere. Now, how small? What's the quantitative dependence? Well, the uniformity, the randomness, is arbitrarily small compared to the complexity of the structured part. So again, with my normalizations, this is just simply the length of the interval n, and that's the maximum possible a one-bounded function's Fourier transform could be. And we're saying we're some growth function of m smaller than that trivial bound. So f of m is some growth function of m. So f of m could be exponential in m. It could be double exponential in m. It could be a tower of twos of high m. It's whatever function you need to get your later argument to work. You're free to specify it beforehand, before you apply the regularity lemma. But the point is, the quality of your randomness is arbitrarily larger or arbitrarily small, whatever way you want to think about it, arbitrarily small compared to the complexity of your structured part, which is m. Okay, let's write down this quantitative dependence. So I've just rewritten everything and deleted this equation to make more room on the slide. So what about the quantitative dependence? So this is for any epsilon greater than zero. So epsilon measures the size of our exceptional set. So we're free to say we only want half of the interval to be our exceptional set, or even 1/1,000,000 proportion of the interval to contribute to the small part. And we're free to specify our growth function. That's how much better our randomness is, our randomness of our uniform part compared to the structure of our main term. Given a smallness and given a growth function, we obtain a level of complexity bounded in terms of the smallness and the growth function. So this is the complexity of the Bohr structure. So a small m is a more structured Bohr translate. And once we've obtained all of those parameters, this decomposition holds for any set A. Obviously, with different structured parts and different small parts and different uniform parts, depending on our set A. And actually, this function, this decomposition holds for any function f. It's not restricted to the indicator function of a set. But that's all I need for our application. Okay. So do let me know if there are further questions on the regularity lemma. There's one further thing I want to assert, and that's that these functions have some additional nice properties. So the structured plus small part is non-negative, and the density of the structured part, the density of this Bohr translate, is essentially the same as the density of your original set. Okay, so this is getting complicated enough. And the reason I say that is to cover my back later when I need to invoke these facts. But why it's important to know the proof of the regularity lemma and not the statement is what we're trying to do is encapsulate all the useful properties of the regularity lemma into an easy to state theorem. But actually, if you know the proof, you can often check that your structured part has lots of the properties you want inherited from your original function because of how you construct these functions. So here's some properties that I needed in the application we're going to consider today. But as I say, often you need your structured part to inherit some properties from your original function. And to check that it inherits those properties, you just have to go into the proof of the regularity lemma. So why does it inherit properties? Well, this is constructed by, you take your interval, 1 up to n, and you chop it up into some coarse pieces. And then you average your function on these coarse pieces. That's going to give you a function g. It's going to be the coarse average. So the value of my function at this point x of my coarse average would be the average of my original function, which is this indicator function, averaged along this coarse piece. And then I'm also going to perform a more refined average. So I'm going to chop up into some more refined pieces. And another function will be the refined average. It's more like a conditional expectation obtained by averaging along pieces. And the way you prove the regularity lemma is you decompose your function into the coarse average, and then an error term coming from the original function minus the refined average. And in the middle, you have to compensate with the refined average minus the coarse average. Okay. And this coarse average is going to be our structured part. The difference between our original function and the refined average is going to be our highly random part. And then the difference between the coarse average and the refined average is going to be the small part. So how would the structured part inherit lots of properties of the original function? It inherits them because it's an average of the original function. So in particular, that's why they have the same density. Okay. So that's the regularity lemma. So what's our application? So we're going to prove Roth's theorem in many variables. Before, we showed that dense sets of integers contain at least one non-trivial three-term progression. Today, we're going to show that dense sets of integers contain many three-term progressions, a positive proportion of the maximum they could contain as a subset of an interval from 1 up to n. But actually, we're not going to work with progressions. A three-term progression is just an example of a solution to a translation invariant equation. So we're going to work with arbitrary translation invariant equations. That's equations whose coefficients sum to zero. So the assumption is we've got translation invariant equation, its coefficients sum to zero, subset of our interval of density at least delta. And the conclusion is the number of solutions to our equation in this dense set is a positive proportion of the maximum possible. So there's S variables, you can fix S minus one of the variables, there's at most N choices for each variable, and the remaining S variable is fixed. So there's at most N to the S minus one solutions to this equation in the interval, and we're showing any dense set has a positive proportion of that maximum. There's some implicit constants. This is uniform in all sets of density delta, and there's an implicit constant depending on delta, the density, but there's also an implicit constant depending on the coefficients of the equation. And that's because if I take some very large coefficient here and some very small coefficient here, I'm likely to have less solutions than other choices of coefficients. So this lower bound has to reflect the number of solutions there are to the equation in the actual interval. And that's why there's a dependence on the coefficients here. So this is what we're going to use the regularity lemma to prove. But we're not going to prove it in this generality because all of this notation just obscures lots of the ideas, and all I want to do is communicate the essential ideas and not results in their maximum possible generality. So I'm going to focus on this equation where the fifth variable is the average of the first four variables. Okay, and as an exercise, if you follow this, you'll definitely be able to prove the general case. So when we looked at three-term progressions, we encoded a three-term progression as a solution to a linear equation. And we're going to do the reverse here. We're going to go from the linear equation to a parameterization. Okay, so you can reparameterize solutions to this equation where, say, the first variable is given this way, here's the second variable, the third variable, the fifth variable corresponds to x, and that determines the fourth variable, it has to equal this. So that's a bijective correspondence between solutions to the equation and a parameterization. So that's useful, that formulation is useful because it helps you motivate why the regularity lemma should give you a proof of this counting result. So I think the regularity is useful for many reasons. One, it gives you global counts. But two, it also sort of gives you an intuition of why a result is true. And with that intuition, you can sort of go on to look at other similar problems with that intuition in hand. So this parameterization gives you a handle on how to show that all dense sets of integers contain many solutions to this equation. And the handle is you only have to show the result for Bohr translates, because that's the heuristic takeaway of the regularity lemma. So why would a Bohr translate contain many configurations of this form? Well, you can, let's think about what's happening on the circle. So in my circle model, I've got a Bohr translate which corresponds to pulling back some arc on the circle. So my point X lies on this arc somewhere. Okay. Now, if I take a neighborhood of the identity, a small neighborhood of the identity, that's a Bohr set. So a Bohr set, as opposed to a Bohr translate, is some small epsilon neighborhood of the identity. Okay. So if I take some parameter, some difference parameter di, and I shift my x coming from my Bohr translate by this di coming from this Bohr set, that's down here, then I'm highly likely to remain within the Bohr translate. So we're working with integers, but we're viewing the integers by mapping them onto the unit circle via a homomorphism coming from this frequency vector theta. And from the perspective of the circle, x and x plus di are very close together. So it's hard to leave the Bohr translate if you're shifting by this Bohr set. Okay. So if the upshot of the regularity lemma is that every set resembles a Bohr translate, that means that there is some Bohr set such that my Bohr translate or my original dense set is approximately sort of almost periodic under shifts from this Bohr set. So the indicator function of my set is almost invariant under shifts from this Bohr set. Okay, now we know how to generate a lot of solutions to our equation in our set A. Because evaluating this configuration where x is can be anything. And if we constrain these shifts di to our Bohr set, this five-fold Cartesian product doesn't really see the shifts from the Bohr set. It doesn't even notice them. So from the perspective of the five-fold Cartesian product, this configuration looks just like the diagonal. Okay, and we've got a dense set. So the five-fold Cartesian product for the dense set is large on the diagonal. It's dense along the diagonal. So how do you generate lots of solutions to your equation? How do you generate n to the four solutions to your equation? Well, you can choose A, choices of x give you an element in the diagonal. And then you can choose B to the three choices of these shift parameters, di. And most of those choices are going to generate a solution to your equation with variables constrained to your dense set A. So the regularity lemma gives you an intuition of why these translation invariant equations have lots of solutions in dense sets. It's because every dense set has a set of shifts such that the diagonal doesn't notice these shifts. Okay. So just to say, we've got a dense set. So the order of magnitude of our set is approximately n, and Bohr sets are dense. So the order of magnitude of b cubed is around n cubed. So we've got around n to the four solutions to our equation in this manner. Excuse me. Okay. So you can make that precise. So let's make that precise with this, checking the result for a Bohr translate. We start with our M Lipschitz function on an M dimensional torus. This is our proxy for a Bohr translate. And we're taking some frequency vector, theta. This is just the output of the regularity lemma. And we obtain a structured function, which is just this Lipschitz function evaluated at theta times x. So we take an integer, we map it to the n-dimensional torus by multiplying it through by the frequency vector, and then we evaluate our function. Here's our set of almost periods. It's a Bohr set determined by our frequencies, theta. We restrict it to some short interval, and we've got some radius eta. So eta is to be determined. But the argument works for any eta. And the conclusion of the lemma is, if we're counting tuples which solve our equation, weighted by this structured function, and we constrain these shifts to this Bohr set, then the number of special solutions generated in this way is almost a positive proportion of the maximum it could be. We've got beta cubed coming from three copies of B. We've got a fifth power, or a mean value of the fifth power of our structured function, and an error term. It looks a bit complicated, but it's worth saying that we expect this term to be b cubed times n. This fifth power should be around size n. So the main term should be comparable to the error term, where there's this sort of factor eta times n, which we need to be small for it to be a genuine error term. So how do we deal with this fifth power, this fifth moment? Well, we use a Holder's inequality. And we can take the fifth power to the outside of the summation, as long as we have a compensating factor of n to the minus four. Now, I said that the expectation of our structured part can be made equal to the density of our original set. And that's where we use this. So our set has a density delta. So we get delta to the fifth times n times b cubed. Okay. So if you want to make this a genuine error term, you have to take eta m to be much smaller than delta to the five. How does the proof of this lemma go? There's absolutely nothing going on. let me just say, all we're doing is writing the structured part, perturbed by this shift coming from the Bohr set. It's just the Lipschitz function evaluated at theta times x plus di. We use the Lipschitz property, so we get that this is f of theta x plus O of m times theta times di on the metric on the m-dimensional torus. Okay, and this quantity is small because di comes from our Bohr set, and this is just our structured function evaluated at x. So it's actually O of eta. Okay, so that was pointwise. So you can replace each of these structured functions shifted by an element of the Bohr set. You can replace it by the function evaluated at x. There's a cost of eta m every time you do that. How many times do you need to do it? Well, how many terms are in our summation? There's around n times v cubed. So that's why this error term gets inflated by n times v cubed. So there's nothing going on in this structured counting lemma. It's just using the Lipschitz property of our structured part. Okay. What about the small part? Now I claim we can prove the same result where instead of just counting these special solutions weighted by our structured part, we can weight by the structured plus small part. So here I'm using this notation for the structured plus small part. And we're assuming the small part has mass epsilon n. So what's the conclusion? The count of the structured plus small part is at most, or at least, the count of the structured part, which we know how to bound from our structured counting lemma, combined with an error, which is epsilon times sort of order of magnitude of our main term. And this epsilon is coming from the mass of our small part. So I'll sketch how that goes in a second. It's the usual telescoping identity. But just to say, we know that this structured part contributes delta to the 5 times n times b cubed. And we've got an error term of epsilon times something of a similar order of magnitude. So if you take epsilon to be sufficiently small in terms of delta, it's no longer, you can throw away the error term, and you've just got a main term, which is, depending on the density, times the length of the interval, times the cardinality of the Bohr set cubed. So how do we remove the small part? Well, you just use linearity to write this structured part as a sum of the structured plus the small part. Use linearity of summation, and you expand the brackets and you get a collection of lots of different sums. The first sum contains only copies of the structured part, and that's going to give us our main term. And the rest is we're summing over solutions to our equation, or special solutions restricted to this Bohr set. And it's a product of bounded functions, at least one of which is equal to the small part. So how do you bound a sum where at least one of the factors has small L1 norm? So that comes from this L1 control lemma. You take a bunch of one bounded functions and you sum over parameters coming from the interval and from this set B, summing over our configuration. And you can bound that by the size of the Bohr set cubed. It doesn't have to be a Bohr set for this lemma. It just has to be a set, finite set, times the L1 norm of whichever function you want. It could be the first function or the second function, whatever. So how does that go? It's just the triangle inequality. You bound this by, you crash through with absolute values, and you get a sum over x of your first function, a sum over di in your Bohr set, absolute value of lots of bounded functions, one bounded functions, And because they're one bounded, you may as well replace the absolute value by one. And you get the L1 norm of one times B cubed. Now, that was for the first function. When I'm bounding in terms of the L1 norm of F1, if I wanted to do it for F2, I'd just first reparameterize x plus d1 as a new variable, x tilde. So this variable becomes x tilde minus d1. This becomes x tilde plus d2 minus d1, and so on. So you reparameterize, and then you hit it with the triangle inequality, just as you did before. Okay. So that accounted for the structured part. And then we saw that we could perturb the structured part by a small part, and we still have lots of solutions. How do we add in the uniform part? This part which is highly random. So we know that when functions have comparable Fourier transform, then the number of solutions to an equation weighted by the first function is comparable to the number of solutions to the same equation weighted by the second function, up to an error which depends on how close their Fourier transforms are. So this is the usual telescoping identity plus Holder's inequality. So in lecture one, we proved a result of this flavor, which was, I sort of paraphrased it as, Fourier uniform sets obey the naive heuristic. And precisely the same argument gives this result. And I mean, you just start off by using orthogonality relations to rewrite the number of solutions to your equation as a Fourier integral. You've got the fourth power corresponding to the first four variables, and the last variable gives you the Fourier transform at minus four alpha. Okay, so you can encode counting solutions to an equation in terms of Fourier transforms. So you see that if Fourier transforms are comparable, then Fourier integrals are comparable. So solution counts are comparable. So we've seen this argument before. So let's use that. We've got that our dense set is a structured part plus a small part plus a uniform part. And let's just remind ourselves, we've got density delta, and the smallness, we've already seen, we're going to have to take that smallness to be sufficiently small in terms of the density delta to get a good main term coming from the structured plus small part. And just to remind us, the uniform part has very small Fourier coefficients. So you use this Fourier control lemma. Because this doesn't contribute much to any of the Fourier transforms of either side of this equation, it's negligible when you come towards counting solutions to an equation. So the number of solutions weighted by our set is similar to the number of solutions weighted by the structured plus small part, because the error term is small in the L hat infinity norm. This is the contribution coming from all of these small Fourier coefficients. Okay. Now, how do we show that this is large? Now, it's worth bearing in mind that we haven't shown a sum of this form is large when we did our structured plus small counting lemma. We showed that this function counts many solutions to this equation of a specific form, where there were certain parameterizations whose variables were constrained to a Bohr set. But now we're counting all solutions to our equation. Well, you can lower bound the total number of solutions by these special solutions coming from constraining these shifts to the Bohr set. Why can you do that? Well, you can do that because this structured plus small part is non-negative. So you're allowed to pass to a smaller subset of solutions because of non-negativity of this function. So that was a little technical wrinkle that we made sure to include in our statement of the regularity lemma. Okay, so we can bound the total number of solutions by these special solutions. Here we've got our error coming from throwing away the uniform part. And we've got a lower bound for this. We proved a lower bound of delta to the 5 times the Bohr set cubed times the length of our interval. Now, we want to show that the error term is smaller than the main term. And at the moment, the error term looks quite different from the main term. Let's think about where the main term is coming from. It's coming from a Bohr set, whose radius is depending on the density and the complexity m. But we do have a nice lower bound for Bohr sets. So in lecture one, we showed that a Bohr set of radius eta and dimension m, there are m frequencies here, you can obtain a lower bound for that, which is the radius to the dimension times the length of the interval. That's around eta to the m plus 1 times n. Okay, so we can incorporate that here. So we get, now we've got an n to the 4 in both error and main term. And our main term has some factors depending on the density and the complexity of our Bohr set. And we need the error term to be smaller than the main term. So let's look at what we've proved. We've got a lower bound for the number of solutions to our equation in our dense set of density delta. Here's our error term, here's our main term. This is a pretty coarse bound for our main term. It's essentially just exponential in the complexity with a delta in the base. But let's check the dependence in the regularity lemma. The regularity lemma allowed us to specify epsilon, specify the growth function, and we turned the handle and it spat out a complexity parameter m, which had this decomposition. We know we need to take our smallness to be polynomial in the density. And you can see from this, if we want the error term to be smaller than the main term, we need our growth function to take this form. It has to be exponential in the complexity with a delta in the base. We can do that because delta is fixed beforehand. Before we've even done the regularity lemma, delta is fixed. It's the density with which we're working. So we're free to define epsilon and the growth function in terms of delta. So with that choice of growth function, we get a uniform lower bound in terms of the delta, in terms of the density and the complexity. It's a horrible looking lower bound depending on delta and m. So let's just forget about it and write it as an implicit constant depending on delta and m. So we've almost proved our Roth theorem in many variables, which claimed that we had a uniform lower bound for the number of solutions to our equation in the set of density delta, which only depended on the density delta, along with the coefficients of our equation. But we've got this complexity parameter here, so it looks like we're not quite done. But this complexity depends only, it's bounded uniformly in terms of the smallness and the growth function, and the smallness and the growth function only depend on delta. So in fact, the complexity is bounded in terms of the density. So we can forget about the complexity dependence here. And we just get a uniform bound in terms of delta. So that proves our many variable version of Roth's theorem, a counting version of that result. And actually we need this counting version for what we're going to look at next time. So what are we going to look at next time? Well, so far, we've concentrated on dense sets of integers. And we've given a number of different ways of counting solutions to equations or exhibiting solutions to equations in dense sets of integers. But a lot of the interesting sets in number theory aren't dense. You've got squares, you've got the primes. So what do you do when your set is sparse? It would be sort of a bit boring if in combinatorial number theory you only ever got to consider dense sets. So what about sparse sets? Sets whose density decays with the length of the interval. For instance, a dense set of squares that would have cardinality at most n to the 1/2, so it's certainly sparse. A random set of cardinality n to the 1/2. relatively dense set of primes, cardinality at most n over log n. Well, next time we'll see that we can actually use something called a transference principle to obtain some results in combinatorial number theory for these sparse sets. And it's a Fourier-analytic transference principle. And what it'll do is you take your sparse set, you put it into this machine of the transference principle, and the transference principle machine outputs a dense set of integers. So it models a sparse set with a dense set. Now we know lots of things about dense sets. For instance, we know that they have many solutions to translation invariant equations. So we can invoke those kind of results for dense sets. And then we put our dense set or our result about dense sets back into the transference machine and sort of pull back a result about sparse sets of integers. So we transfer the result back to the sparse set. So almost for free, you get results about sparse sets of integers by just invoking stuff about dense sets of integers. So that's what we're going to look at next time. Great. So that's all I had to say for today. So I'm going to stop recording now. And if people have questions, feel free to unmute and ask away. And if you don't have any question, feel free to leave the meeting and go and enjoy your dinner. I'll see you another time. But yeah, those who are interested, please do ask questions.
So I have a question regarding the regularity lemma. So would it be correct to say that this F strut, so basically it's telling you where to look for these solutions? So in other words, for example, if I, you know, you pass to this Bohr set, which I think you denoted B, but suppose I don't want to do that and I want to count all the solutions. Yep. And then that would be like you have a certain, you know, M Lipschitz function on this M dimensional torus, and then average of which is D. And then you are taking this sort of convolution or whatever to call it, right? So you have this X, D1, D2, D3, D4 maybe, and you are looking at these products, F star of X times. So would that count all the solutions?
Yeah, so I guess the regularity lemma says if you want to count all the solutions, you only have to count it for this Bohr translate, for this Lipschitz function. So in our lecture, we were just concerned with the lower bound for counting the number of solutions. And it was easy to manufacture lots of specific solutions to get the lower bound. And if you wanted to obtain a global count all solutions, an asymptotic formula, you would obtain, I'm sorry if my internet connection isn't very good right now, you would obtain a asymptotic formula for the number of solutions, and it would essentially be a product of local densities times an integral over a Lipschitz function on a torus. So it would give you a genuine asymptotic formula. The problem is at the level of generality we're working with, this Lipschitz function could be quite arbitrary and not like interesting. But if you're working with some specific set of integers where you could extract some structure of this Lipschitz function, then it would give you an asymptotic form. Yeah.
But, okay, so suppose I really want to get the right constant. So, right, so my delta is 0.1 and I really want to know the constant